will start with our nose. Are the nose okay? Okay. Alright, nose. Why do you need nose? What happens with the air in your nose? What do you say? Yes, it filters. So there are like, if you go to the dusty place, your nose will be coming, your nose will be filtering the air, and the dust will be coming with some so big dust particles. What else happens with the air in your nose? Well, worms, yes. Why do we need to warm the air? Because what is the difference between when you breathe with your nose and when you breathe with your... How does it feel? So why do we need warm air?
Homeostasis.
Yeah, first of all, we need it warm because our body is warm, because at that temperature all our metabolic processes are proceeding more comfortably. Second, the air is coming into the lungs. And of course, as every open cavity, there are beneficial bacteria living there that prevent bad bacteria from coming to the lungs. So that's another thing. And those bacteria, they like our body temperature. So it warms up the air. What else is in the nose? The air is coming in your nose, and there's something. What else is coming to the air? Except particles.
Smell.
So, in chapter 14, we will study different sensory receptors that are located in the nose, but. Does filter out the smells and send the signal to the brain, because the ability of our nose to distinguish between different smells is amazing. It's one molecule per like 7 million of other molecules. There are certain smells that we realize, like for example bleach or some odors. These are chemical molecules, flying chemical molecules that go and activate our receptors, and we assign the meaning of smell in the brain. There are also the smells that we don't realize that we smell, but we feel. For example, if you saw those articles that say that we can smell the other person's genes, genetic makeup, it has some truth in it. Because those invisible molecules, they're actually some sub-products of immune... let me start from the very beginning. The researchers took a group of men and make them sweat in their t-shirts, and then offered those t-shirts to women to smell and tell the researchers which smell of t-shirts they prefer. And when they analyzed the smell, they found out that the women in general prefer the smell of the man whose genetic makeup is different from the woman's genetic makeup. This smell was produced by the subproduct of proteins of immune system, and from evolutionary point of view, it becomes clear that the more variety of immune system genes we have, the better we are equipped to fight the bacteria. So that is another example. The other example of smell may be those so-called pheromone molecules. The existence of pheromones, the chemical substances that can change personal behavior at a distance, the existence and action of those pheromones is proved just for the insects at that point of biology, but we have the right to suspect that something like that acts on us as well. So this is the smell. All right, so the nose is the first organ, the first body part on the way of the air. Then, when the air comes in, we have pharynx, nasal cavity, pharynx. Where is the area of pharynx? Yeah, it's starts deep in the throat, and then it goes where glottis, epiglottis are, and esophagus starts that area. So we have here like multiple openings. First of all, the air from the nose is coming there. Let me draw it. Okay, remember how we, how do I draw a person with a nose? Okay, here's the nose, and here's the digestive system of the person, and here's the respiratory system of the person, and there, like right here, with epiglottis covering glottis, which is the beginning of windpipe. At the very beginning of, okay, nose, pharynx, then glottis, which is simply the opening, and then larynx. Anybody got laryngitis at some point in time? So how does it feel? What does it affect?
Voice.
Yeah. Here is the larynx. There are special voice muscles that were folds that will regulate and make different sounds. So larynx is a voice box. Then here is the windpipe. We call it trachea. Windpipe is covered with so-called pseudostratified epithelium. This, what is the function, by the way, of the epithelial tissue?
It's like covering, protecting.
Yeah, covering, protective, deep inside, exchange, and so on. It has something that, like brush border or hairs, and these hairs, we can call them hairs of the cell, they are involved in taking smaller particles and some bacteria or something out, because they work as a broom in one direction, taking everything out of the respiratory system. Smoking will inactivate those hair of epithelial cells for an hour. So that's why just smoking, like binge smoking, like 5 cigarettes in a day, probably is better than chain smoking, because if this is being inactivated, all the stuff gets deep in the lungs. And lungs are just like heaven destination for pathogenic bacteria, because it's moist, it's warm, and it's a great media for bacteria, for pathogenic bacteria to reproduce. So you have trachea here, and what I would like you to remember about trachea, two things. The first thing is this one, covered with pseudostratified epithelium. Pseudostratified is, means that if you look at the microscope for those cells, you will see that like they form two layers of cells, just because if you're gonna look at the nuclei, they kind of position at different level, which gives the impression of like two rows of cells, but it's actually one row of cells. The second thing that I would like you to remember about trachea, that it has the rings of cartilage. Rings. There are actually two pipes that go down from here to here, esophagus and trachea. And they kind of occupy the same space. So esophagus looks like a fire hose pipe, totally flat, and when food goes in, it's just, it stretches a little bit. Trachea has to be kept open, so it has like rings, you know, like this dryer exhaust, you know, it's not totally flat, there's something that holds it open, okay? And this is done with the help of cartilage. You will see it in the lab. The pipes that stay open all the time is a trachea. The second tube that looks like a fire hose pipe is esophagus. That is different. So you see cartilages rings like here. And then trachea will split into bronchi. This is plural, bronchi. So we will have right bronchus and left bronchus, like here. What are bronchi? Kind of extensions of trachea that will deliver the air into the lungs. Keep in mind that there's no exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide with the cells of the body, because it's just a highway for the air, no exchange, nothing. Just a highway to the air, for the air to get to lungs. It's like artery and veins that just deliver the blood to certain capillary beds for exchange. So then bronchi will split into smaller rods, bronchioles. Remember, arteries, arterioles, bronchi, bronchioles, so small bronchi. So you see that the smaller pathways. And finally, finally, each
bronchiole will end with a structure that are called alveoli. Singular is alveolus, which is one small bag, small compartment. But these alveoli, in a way, are similar to capillary beds, actually, huge capillary beds come here because those alveoli, oxygen is being exchanged for carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is being exchanged for the oxygen. And this is the only place of the exchange. I would like you to draw a huge capillary bed right here, but not right here. Not anywhere here, just right here. Just to keep remember that the exchange happens in alveoli only. Remember this, this is pulmonary circuit. The blood is coming from right the ventricle of the heart. It goes to lung, to the lungs. That's where it gets exchanged. And then comes back to the left atrium of the heart. Now let's talk about alveoli. First, oh, what is the lung? The lung that's shown here is like the whole area right here, including all of the alveoli and those bronchioles that are connected. Now, what I would like you to remember about alveoli is that they are covered with squamous epithelium tissue. It's like totally, totally flat cells with a big surface to accept as much oxygen as they possibly can. Squamous epithelium. So we have bacteria here. Bacteria. Bacteria live here. Good bacteria prevent us from bad bacteria. Now, there are glands that keep the air moist. Plus, what happens if you just bring two wet pieces of paper together? Let's say you spilled water on your homework. What do you do next? You pull them apart, yes, because they all of a sudden and put them separately to dry up. Because water that is on your paper, in your lungs, water tends to form hydrogen bonds with another surface covered by water. So if we have everything moist, so how do we keep the lungs open? The glands here create a special chemical that is called surfactant. From the word surface, surfactant. And this chemical is able to get between the molecules of water, thus destroying the possibility of making hydrogen bonds. Those surfactant is made, well, starting from 7-8 months of pregnancy. So the preemies, babies that are born prematurely, they cannot breathe on their own because their lungs are kind of glued, the surface of the lungs is glued to one alveolus, to another alveolus. so the lungs cannot be open. If the surfactant is there with the first baby breath, the air comes in and everything will start working. So, but if it's not there, so we need a certain life support to wait until it's made in the lung. Okay, now as you can see, the surface, the overall surface that algae life provide is very important. So when you take swimming, kind of stretching your lungs, and you know, if you took swimming seriously, there are special tests just to check how much air you can get in, because it's impossible to have the swim under the water. So what pneumonia, emphysema do, they will destroy the border between. Okay, right here, page 201. You see the alveoli providing the surface for exchange, and what emphysema and pneumonia do, they merge those air sacs into one, the surface decreases, and that's why the person will have trouble breathing. Now let's look at the other. Let's go back. Yeah, pay attention that here's pulmonary artery coming, then exchange will happen, and oxygenated blood flow back. We have to complete our drawing by drawing a diaphragm, which will help us to breathe. Okay, mechanism of breathing. Oh, the other. This is that we can possibly have. Okay, nose and sinus, right here. Why you get stuck with a stuffy nose? It's not the actual stuff that is there, it's the blood vessels that dilate and close the nasal cavity. Then, okay, pharyngitis, laryngitis, right here, infection is located in larynx. You will lose your voice because those folds cannot vibrate as intensely. Then you get bronchitis. The infection is located here. The mucus is formed right here, your immune system is fighting it. It's right here. Bronchitis is not that scary as pneumonia, which means that infection is right here. When your body fights it, it creates a lot of fluid. Fluid prevents the exchange of carbon dioxide and oxygen, so it's definitely not enough air to breathe. Pneumonia leads to emphysema because it decreases the surface that is open for exchange. And while we are talking about exchange, let's talk about how oxygen travels in the blood and how carbon dioxide travels in the blood. So, who remembers, how does oxygen travel in the blood? How do we carry oxygen? Okay, oxygen is in the lungs right now. It's taken from alveoli with the help of squamous epithelium.
going to chat about that. Gas exchanges in the body. So, where do we put that? So, oxygen. What do we connect?
Hemoglobin. Hemoglobin.
Hemoglobin. Where is hemoglobin located?
Red blood
cells. Red blood cells. So we have to look at the red blood cells. When red blood cells mature, they lose a nucleus. So all the cell volume. So they look like discs, concave discs, all filled with hemoglobin. What is a hemoglobin in regards to being a macromolecule? Is it fat? Is it?
It is
a protein. So in order for this protein to function, what element of periodic table does it need? Okay, hydrogen, phosphorus, iron, carbon. What element does it need? What?
Iron.
Yes, iron. Remember, you got recommendation to eat iron if you have anemia. Anemia means you don't have enough of oxygen in your body. Anemia means that it can be caused by several reasons. So I would like you to put some dots of different color into your hemoglobin and mark it iron. What is sickle cell anemia? The red blood cells look like sickles because of, who remembers? Because of the change of DNA code in hemoglobin gene. Remember, each protein is coded in DNA. This is a genetic mutation for sickle cell anemia, and the protein shape that I drew like this in here now changed into like this shape. So is it capable of holding iron? Yes. Has iron. I can draw iron here as well. So you will get anemia here if you lose too much blood because of something, but so you have to wait to get back to normal when your body, to give your body an opportunity to create a lot of blood cells. You can get an anemia if you don't have an iron in your diet, because those hemoglobin needs iron to hold on to oxygen. Or you can get an anemia because of genetic mutation, sickle cell anemia. There are also like beta thalassemia and some other process, because of the wrong shape of hemoglobin protein. And in this case, is this hemoglobin functional? Yes, it is. But in this case, because of the cell shape, those cells will get stuck in your blood vessels and be destroyed. And the difference between these cells, this one will live for 120 days. This one will live for 90 days. So your body has to work over time creating and making those blood cells. Plus, when they are dying, there are not enough of blood cells, so not enough of oxygen. So I would like you to put here oxygen molecule, which is O2 molecule, the two atoms of oxygen in the molecule. And remember that oxygen is carried by red blood cells. So when the oxygen, there are special enzymes that proteins that will help put oxygen into red blood cells. And there are special enzymes deep in the body when
those blood cells will make their way to the body cells. There are special enzymes to release the oxygen from red blood cells so the oxygen can diffuse into every cell. The exchange, see, we have things here for internal and external respiration. So external respiration happens in the alveolis, external. So carbon dioxide goes out, oxygen gets in. And internal respiration is when red blood cells make their way to each and every cell of the body, and now they release the oxygen to those muscle cells or epithelial cells. Okay, carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide, CO2 formula. First thing to remember, it does not travel in red blood cells. Just a small percentage of carbon dioxide travels in red blood cells. But what I do want you to remember is when carbon dioxide is being put in the blood, it will meet water in the blood and will form carbonic acid. This is good to remember chemical formula of carbonic acid, because it's just if you add this to this and put hydrogen first, you will see that it's just one compound. What is a carbonic acid? First of all, it all happens in the blood. And let me put it this way. You know that plants do not eat rocks, right? They don't. But they still need certain elements of periodic table for their enzymes to work so the plant can grow. So if we have rocks and water, how do we free those elements of periodic table from the rocks? And that's a mystery, a great luck of our Earth, that it is able to make carbonic acid. Because if you imagine like a river surface or ocean surface or something, there's the oxygen coming in. Here is the water right here. Here's a carbonic acid created, and as an acid it will dissolve rocks and also some other rocks which carry those elements of periodic table that plants will suck up as ions. Ions are charged particles. Ions are like, let's say, chemically friendly in most cases. And those ions of elements, periodic table elements, just go and make working enzymes. So here's the same process. Our carbon dioxide that is being expelled from every working cell will meet water, will create carbonic acid, and then carbonic acid will disintegrate to hydrogen ion and bicarbonate ion. And we already know the use for bicarbonate ion. Remember pancreas? That will neutralize the acid. Pancreas use bicarbonate ion. Also, there are a certain amount of bicarbonate ion in our saliva. It's used as a basic component when it loses this hydrogen ion. But in our blood, this hydrogen ion gets detected. This is called blood acidosis. So if you don't have enough of oxygen, you will develop blood acidosis. And it means that you want to breathe, hold your breath for a while. You know how it happens when a kid says, well, I'm going to die, I'm not going to breathe, mom. So how you do that? So what happens, no oxygen, but a little carbon dioxide. So the pH of the blood goes up. It's called blood acidosis. And immediately those receptors, those sensors in the walls of our blood vessels will detect the blood acidity because they always control the chemical composition of the blood. They will send an electrical signal to the brain, and brain will say, breathe. So you cannot hold the breathe consciously for a very long time before it becomes unconscious, involuntary process of breathing. So the opposite thing, when let's say you had too much oxygen in your blood, it's called blood alkalosis. Not enough of carbon dioxide in your blood. When does it happen? When you can get too much oxygen in your blood? Well, they usually, you know, they don't put you on life support and give you just the oxygen. It's a mix. So it usually happens when you start, when people get hysterical. Yeah, hyperventilation will cause blood alkalosis, which means that pH becomes basic, and it happens when a person is getting hysterical, and then you have a person become dizzy, and what is recommended is to breathe into some bag, brown bag, so your blood pH will go back up. Or another way of using blood alkalosis is before the start for athletes, what do they do? But when they sprint out for the finish line, that's where this oxygen is used up very quickly. So in this case, it's an athletic strategy to get as much blood as, or to get as much oxygen as you can. Also, what could be done here athletically? You probably heard about EPO scandal. Erythropoietin is a hormone that that is made by the kidney and is being sent to red bone marrow to make more blood cells. Remember, every blood cell birthplace is red bone marrow. So what athletes, bicyclists did in the past, they gave themselves injection of erythropoietin. Well, right now it's harness racing or thoroughbred racing commission fights that in a horse racing, the same process. So athletes will, there will be a bunch of red blood cells created in the blood. They kind of collected, drawing them, saving them, and then before the competition, given injection, putting it back into the cardiovascular system, this increased number of red blood cells by injection. Taking it out, saving it, giving it back. So, but our body also controls the number of red blood cells, and they didn't know that. So when the blood becomes too loaded with red blood cells, or any cells for this reason, it has trouble passing through the heart. So those several bicyclists died from heart failure at once in the competition, that's where attention was really drawn to erythropoietin, and all assumptions were made, and
So same thing happens with the horses. My mistake. Okay. So, what I want you to remember about carbon dioxide, it travels in the blood as a bicarbonate ion, as a chemical, as a separate chemical, bicarbonate ion. So just put here, travels, carbon dioxide, travels as bicarbonate ion. Oxygen travels in red blood cells. Okay, what we have is the general division, what we missed. So upper respiratory tract, which ends with the larynx, and lower respiratory tract, which includes everything else. So respiratory system disease, split into upper respiratory tract disease and lower. Let's look. What are pleura in your vocabulary? Pleuras are the membranes enveloping the lungs. So the lungs will not like rub the other organs or. Because you know those alveoli, they are very fragile. So write in your vocabulary, pleura, membranes and encase them, envelop them, the lungs. And you will have pleuritis, which is inflammation, those membranes. Mechanism of breathing in short. When you move your rib cage and diaphragm, it creates a negative pressure, you know, like vacuum cleaner. Here's in, you breathe out, here's out. There is a part, now I would like you to pay attention to this table. When you're sitting or laying down or something, notice how you breathe. You breathe slightly. You're almost not moving your rib cage. So this is called tidal volume. It's right here. This is average lung volume, milliliter. 1 milliliter is about, like, you know, if you take your pinky and get like the nail area, that's about the volume of 1 milliliter. Yeah, I grew up with metric system, so trust me on this one. Meter? No. Okay, so tidal, and liter is about, you know, a quart, close to a quart. So gallon is 4 liters. So we have here, so tidal volume is from here to here is like half of the quart, tidal volume. That's what is being exchanged, this amount of air is being exchanged every time you breathe when you just sit and listen to me. Now if you run and do maximum expiration or inspiration. See how much you can spread your lungs? Depending on how much pneumonia and emphysema you have, you can either spread it or just slightly spread it. That is called inspiratory volume and expiratory volume. Vital capacity of the lungs, what is called vital capacity, goes from, I ask you to breathe out totally, and then inhale as much as you can. That is your vital capacity, what you can rely on.
And what is a residual volume? Of course, when you breathe out, you cannot get rid of the whole air. There's still air that's staying in your trachea, in your bronchi. Or, of course, alveoli will not like totally fall. This is your residual volume. It's not like really useful, but this is the residual volume. And that's what it means. Now, nervous control of breathing and chemical control of breathing. A nervous control of breathing is what I want you to remember, that there's a respiratory center which is located in medulla oblongata. What else is located in medulla oblongata? Heart control. So a very ancient part of the brain. Okay, there is also respiratory center. Medulla oblongata is part of brainstem bacteria, also your hiccups and some reactions you cannot control. And chemical control of breathing is related to those chemoreceptors. And the detectant is the blood too acidic or too basic. So, like sensing the chemistry of the blood. Now, if you look at the book, you will see external respiration versus internal respiration. When we talk about external respiration, we address processes, chemical processes that happen in the lungs. With internal respiration, we address chemical processes that happen deep in the body, in those capillary beds. Now you have a subchapter or description of the disease. And just remember that they are named by their location. Remember that pneumonia is a liquid pus and tissue fluid. Alveoli are filled with that. Hard to breathe. Not a lot of pain, but it's hard to breathe because the surface of the exchange is very, very limited. Pulmonary fibrosis, once again, have asbestos. You see asbestos here. Connective tissue is now replacing the epithelial tissue. Connective tissue is not capable of any exchanges. So when epithelial tissue is gone, once again, the exchange of carbon dioxide and oxygen is becomes very limited. Pulmonary tuberculosis. See, the tubercular is encapsulation of those bacteria. They also affect the breathing surface of alveoli and elasticity of lungs is reduced. Emphysema. Emphysema is usually the result of pneumonia or some other destructive processes. You see how alveoli emerge now and the surface is decreased. Bronchitis, airways means bronchitis, are covered with mucus. That's where infection is. Now, what is asthma? And asthma is could be a consequence of allergies. Asthma is a dilation of blood vessels. As a result of allergen or some other process, those dilation of blood vessels will squeeze our pathways. So once again, the air is not coming into the lungs. So some people have allergy for cold air. That can happen. The response to different allergens depend on our immune system. Remember, these are cells that should not be reacting to this allergen, but for some reason they do and activate the processes and the allergenic processes. One of those consequences is a dilation of blood vessels, and the blood vessels, when they puff up, will constrict the airway, so the person will have trouble breathing. Okay, scary pictures. Lung cancer. In general, the destruction of lung tissue. So, the oxygen and carbon dioxide. Okay, now let's check our vocabulary. And let's go over path of air. It starts with nose, then pharynx, then what? What is there in pharynx? Is that definitely the lung? Well, it's not an area, it's rather an opening, which is called glottis. So I would like you to put it in here. Then we have glottis will open into larynx, which is a voice box. Larynx will become trachea. The trachea will split into bronchi. The bronchi will split into smaller bronchi, which are called bronchioles, and each bronchiole will end into a bunch of alveoli. Yes. As you can see, there is no word lungs here. Right? Because we split lungs into smaller parts. We don't put lung here. Now, pleura are those membranes around the lungs. Tidal volume is the volume of air at rest. Vital capacity the volume of air coming into the lungs from maximum expiration to maximum inspiration, or vice versa. That one. So, or it's like total capacity of lung minus residual volume that overstays in your respiratory system when you make maximum expiration. Now, SIDS is sudden infant death syndrome, which happens. Respiratory control center is located in the brain, in the lab language of the brain. Chemoreceptors are the structures that measure chemical composition of the blood. Later on, we will see the other bunch of chemoreceptors. Could measure chemical composition of the blood. So the word receptor in biology can be confusing because it is a protein that is sitting on a cell membrane. It's a receptor. It's something that fills the composition. At the same time, we can the whole cells working as a receptor. In this case, it's not a structural part, it's a whole function of the special cell to work as a receptor, let's say, for chemical composition, for smell, and so on. Now, bicarbonate ion, you can put a formula and say this is the way how carbon dioxide travels in the blood. The carbon dioxide molecule is being trapped here because You know, we don't have bubbles in our blood. And carbon dioxide and oxygen are gases. So we need to convert them to something. Do not forget that. We do not have bubbles of oxygen and bubbles of carbon dioxide. So oxygen molecules are being tied down to the iron and hemoglobin in red blood cells. And carbon dioxide is trapped in the carbonate ion, which is used by different body systems for basically maintenance of the blood. Now, hemoglobin protein in the red blood cells that traps oxygen. And then I pick know what is affected in pneumonia, alveoli, bronchi, and emphysema. Once again, alveoli are affected, or surface of alveoli. That's where those three major respiratory system diseases are located. Well, and that's it. Class dismissed. Drive safely. Stay.